we get started, have you ever come across somebody in your life that said, you know, I'm really supposed to love you. I mean, I don't like you, but I have to love you. And you think about the motivation of, oh, that's really good. Just imagine if Jesus said that to us. You know, I don't really like you, but because my father made me go and die for you, I have to love you. The motivation of why we love people is really, really important. We're going to explore that throughout the whole service today. And we're also going to see that in the sermon while we read what Paul is writing to Philemon today. We're studying the book of Philemon. So motivation is really, really important. I mean, you want to do the right thing, but you want to do the right thing for the right reason. And you and I are here because we want to worship God, right?
Yes, we are.
Okay, that's three of you said that. So the rest of you, we want to be here because we want to worship God, right? Yes, yes. Come on, church. We want to do this. And whether it's three or 3,000, it doesn't matter to God. So we are just really grateful. So let's begin our service. Thank you for being here. Would you please stand? And this Trinitarian greeting that we've been using for probably 1,700 years, Paul used it as well. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Now the call to worship, which is a psalm. Every week we read a part of a psalm, the call to worship. Listen to this. Within, and say amen if you agree to this. Within your temple, O God, we meditate on your unfailing love.
Amen.
Like, here's a temple, it's a symbolism, I get that. And within that, with God's people, all of whom have different ideas and different opinions, guess what? We don't all agree on the same things. Whether it's COVID, theology, politics, or what car you drive, we have differences of opinions on that. But in the temple of God, together, we don't concentrate on our differences. We concentrate on our love for God, right? That's, you love God and I love God, and that's why we're brothers and sisters. And so even in the temple here, together as a community, that's really important, we meditate not just on God's love, but what sort of love does the psalmist tell us it is?
Unfailing.
It'll never fail you. God's love will never fail you, no matter what you're going through. You can stand up and say, no matter what I'm going through, God is going to come through for me. And how many times has he not come through for you in life? In that he's got a good track record. So that's what we're going to meditate today, about the love, and specifically today about the motivation for love. Why are you doing this? Why do you love people and how do you love them? So that's the message. Well, let's go back to the Salvation Army. Booth, I think, wrote this, didn't he? Come on, and let's stand and let's sing the fire. Do we need the fire of the Holy Ghost today? We absolutely do. So we invite the Holy Spirit.
The singing on Friday was wonderful, outstanding, amazing, just like our normal singing. I want us to connect not only with the melody and the words, you know, like we're doing the right words and all that type of thing. Let's worship the Lord deeply from our hearts. We love you, Lord, and we need you.
Down and see this waiting host at 7.
will give thanks to thee, O Lord among the people. I will sing praises to thee among the nations. For thy steadfast love is great.
Beginning and the end, the God of the tree.
May your light shine brighter and brighter across this nation, Canada, Lord. We cry out for the nation of Canada. We cry out from the lowest to the highest, to the least, to the most important, Lord, that we would say is most important. Lord, have your way. Bend us, Lord, before you, we ask. That this nation and the world would see that you are great, great, mighty, holy, righteous, ever-loving, faithful, compassionate, merciful, true, truth, shepherd, worthy. Your people recognize that you are worthy. Forgive our land. Forgive us. Rend the heavens and come down, Lord.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God.
Sit down again. Let's pay attention and listen. God's saying to us?
Stay the course.
Stay the course.
You're my sanctuary.
You're my sanctuary.
Fear not.
Fear not.
Thank you.
Cool. Great. Thank you. Be seated. Well, we want to welcome our visitors. We have some visitors today. Thank you. Del and Linda with a Y, as I remembered. Where are you guys from? Like, where do you live?
White Rock.
In White Rock. Well, we especially love people from White Rock. So let's welcome formerly a great All Saints Community Church welcome for Del and Linda. Welcome to you. Thank you. And thanks to Elaine, who's staying home and just making sure she's not too vulnerable to COVID, because she has some other things that she's got to watch out for her health. But Elaine's at home, and Janice is here. And Janice, I do believe we have a couple of kids at Joy Time today. So, so double pay for today. So kids, it's time for Joy Time. And if you want to go and see what we're doing today at Joy Time, come and join Auntie Janice. And then just remember, at the end of the service, I need some help with the blessing as well, the kids. Last Friday, all the pastors who were here, 11 or so of them, came up and helped with the blessing. And then on Sunday, the children helped with the blessing. Well, we're reading, we're working our way through the book of, depends on which hemisphere you come from. It's either Philemon or Philemon. We're going to say Philemon in the northern hemisphere. They say Philemon in the southern hemisphere. Different Greek, I guess. I don't know. But we're going to be working our way through that. And just to give you a heads up, that's going to take us through till Lent. And then during the season of Lent, I'm going to be talking about spiritual disciplines, as I usually do. These ones will be different. These are how you practice your Christianity in community, spiritual disciplines. But for now, read it. Come and read to us from the book of Philemon. It's just a few short readings.
So our reading is from Philemon, verses 8 to 11. Therefore, although in Christ, I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I prefer to appeal to you on the basis of love. It is as one other than Paul, an old man, and now also in prison of Christ Jesus, that I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he has become useful both to you and to me. The word of the Lord.
So Paul is writing to his friend Philemon. Oh, by the way, the notes are on page 7. I just want to make 3 points today, and I've given you half the sentence, and if you want to, you can fill in the other half. Paul is writing to his good friend, fellow Christian leader, and leader of the house church, possibly the leader of the house church in Colossae. At least the house church is meeting in Philemon's home. And we've read over the last couple of weeks that Paul writes to Philemon. He says, I always thank God for you in my prayers. I hear about your love because of how you love God's holy people. I hear about the faith you have in the Lord Jesus. And Paul says in verse 7, gives me great joy. And you're a great encouragement, but the way you love people and the way you have faith in the Lord Jesus. And he continues on in verse 7, he says, Philemon, the way you love God's people and the faith you have in Jesus not only is an encouragement to me, but it refreshes the hearts of the Lord's people. So I just want you to understand this. Your faith is not in a vacuum. When you love God's holy people and you have faith in the Lord Jesus, it impacts the people around you. It refreshes the hearts of God's people. Now you're going to say, oh, look, I live on my own. Nobody ever knows. I don't have any impact on anyone. That is actually a lie from the pit. Now, let me prove it to you. When I do funerals for seniors, and Ed and I have done lots of these, and Ed, I'm sure you've testified to this, we do funerals for seniors, and the one surviving granddaughter says, Grandma, passed away, and she survived everybody else in the world, all her friends, all her family. There's nobody that knows her and nobody that loves her. And I say, well, you should put an ad in the paper. Oh, no. Nobody knows her. She survived everybody. And then you do the funeral, a whole bunch of people turn up. Somebody who knew Grandma from 40 years ago, who Grandma had a great impact in that person's life, and that person needs to be at the funeral just to process the grieving of someone that they knew 40 years ago. How many of you know somebody who 30 years ago had a huge impact on you spiritually? And you, right, and you've maybe not seen them since then, but if they passed away, wouldn't you want to be at their funeral? Just to thank God for them? Paul is trying to say to Philemon, you have an impact on people. And I'm trying to say to you, you and me, I'm the upfront guy, so obviously I have an impact. But you, maybe you don't know like anybody that knows about you, but you have an impact on people. While you're breathing, you have an impact on people. So then, Paul, after building up Philemon, he goes on, verse 6, and he says, look, here's my prayer for you. Now, really interesting. You take the prayer from someone spiritually like Paul, and then you take the prayer from someone who's a worldly spiritual person. And the worldly spiritual person would pray this. My prayer is that you'll have lots of money and that you'll be happy. And you'll have health and you'll have great security. That's what many spiritual people pray. This is what Paul's prayer. I pray that you might be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing. Look, if there was ever a time we needed a good understanding of all good things, it would be today. How can you make decisions about anything, not just medicine, about life, about spirituality, if you don't have good understanding? In other words, Paul's prayer for Philemon and for you and for me is that we might have wisdom. Wisdom, right? The understanding, knowledge, which gets applied, wisdom. Now, you notice in 25 verses, that's the whole of this epistle, 25 verses, we're up to verse 8 and we still haven't found out the purpose of why Paul is writing the letter. Now, Paul, in his wisdom, is a brilliant orator and a brilliant letter writer, and he's been using a traditional method of writing letters to encourage Philemon as a reconciliation with Onesimus. So that's why the build-up. It's not insincere, but it's an appropriate way. You build up the person, you tell them what you like about them, and then you request, here's the request. So we've got a third of the way through the letter, no purpose yet. Ultimately, Paul is going to ask Philemon to accept Onesimus back. If you've been listening to the series, Onesimus was a slave, an indentured slave. He owed Philemon a lot of money, and he decided to get out of town, and he went to Rome and hide in the big city of Rome. And on the way out of Philemon's home, he probably took some of the cutlery or the silver salt and pepper shakers or whatever. He possibly stole some stuff as well as he went into Rome. Onesimus meets Paul in prison. Get that. Isn't that amazing? Paul's in prison and he meets Onesimus. Paul's in prison and he's encouraging people in Caesar's household. Paul's no respecter of persons. And this letter is also no respecter of persons. Whether you're a slave, whether you're in Caesar's household, it doesn't matter. Onesimus gets saved, becomes a Christian, and decides to serve Paul in prison. Paul is in house arrest, right? Which means people can come and go. He's just, he can't go, but he's in a house sort of environment. People come and bring him food and all that sort of stuff. So Onesimus actually becomes one of Paul's servants, in a sense of helping him and serving him. So in this masterful way, Paul begins his appeal, and he does the appeal in stages, and so I've entitled my sermon today, Motivated by Love. Motivated by love, let that sink in, as opposed to being motivated by being told to love someone. We'll see that in a minute. So here's verse 8. Now Paul comes to the crux of the matter. Therefore, that is what was written previously, therefore, because in light of your love for God's holy people and in the light of the fact that you have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, therefore, although in Christ as your spiritual father, I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do. Philemon, you better go, Onesimus, you better go back to Philemon and you better go set things right, because I am telling you. You've probably never had a boss that used authority to motivate you, but I have, and it's a pain. You better do this or else. And Paul says, I could do that. And yet in verse 9 he says, I prefer a different method. Here's my request, Philemon. I could order you to do this. I'm the boss, and here's what I want you to do. Now, your turn, church. What's the problem with that method of leadership?
Nobody responds well to ordering.
Nobody responds well. You know that, Cal. Like, it's sort of like saying, look, you know, standing before the gates, the pearly gates in front of people, Peter, you know, before you get in, look, I never really wanted to be here. Someone made me get here now. Like, it doesn't work. And when you have a boss that doesn't know how to manage you, doesn't know, you know, in the business world, they call it stroking management. You work out what strengths are and you harness them. You nullify the person's weaknesses. You harness their strengths. You work out what their strengths are because you spend time with them to find out what they're good at. And Paul discovers, long time ago, when he was Saul, he probably used the ought method. You better do this. Now just imagine trying to force somebody, order someone to love someone. Well, honey, I love you. Not, I don't say that to Jenny, but I'm using that as an example. Imagine someone, you know, I love you.
What's more with feeling?
And honey will say, well, why? Well, because my boss told me to tell you that. It doesn't work. Maybe go dig a trench. You can dig a trench with a bad attitude, but to love someone with the wrong motivation doesn't work. That's why we're talking about motivated by love. You can't tell someone that you must love somebody else. I mean, they can do it, I really love you. But if it's not inside, it's really hard. Like, that doesn't work. Ultimately, if Philemon is going to forgive Onesimus and love him as a Christian brother, it's going to have to come from within. Love doesn't come from outside, it comes from within. So here's my first point I want to see on page 7. You see, giving orders to love someone never works. It never works. So we get to verse 9 and says, Paul says, well, look, here's the alternative. I'm not going to force you to love Onesimus, but Philemon, I'm going to appeal to you on the basis of love. On the basis of love, I'm going to ask you to love Onesimus. And he adds here, the second part of verse 9, it's none other than me, the great apostle Paul, who's now just an old man and I'm in chains. not just with the Roman government, but I'm in chains for Christ. I'm a Christian servant, of a slave of Jesus. In verse 10, I appeal to you for my own son, Onesimus. But there's a better way than ordering someone to love somebody else. Paul says, I appeal to you on the basis of love. It is possible that, Philemon, you could love Onesimus because of the love of Christ in you. God's love in you allows you to love other people. And have a look at how I, Paul the Apostle, have loved you, Philemon. I've modeled that love to you. My love to you was not a forced love that I ought to. My love for you, says Paul to Philemon, was because God's love is in me. And I loved you. I wanted to love you. Now, Philemon, search the love of God inside you and see if you can't love Onesimus. I'm not telling you that you must love Onesimus. I'm asking you to consider loving him because of the love of Christ inside you. Now get this, this is something the world can't do. The world can't love agape love, what we call agape love. The world can't love agape love other people without Christ in them. Then it's just worldly love, filial love. And let me just say as an aside, as you and I navigate the whole COVID thing and all the public health orders and all of that sort of stuff, the love of Christ, the authentic love of Christ in us, the agape love, is what allows us to love each other even though we have a difference of opinion on things. Whether you're vaccinated or not vaccinated, whether you wear a mask or don't wear a mask, whether you do this or you don't do that, whether you believe this media or you believe that media or whatever, the love of Christ in us allows us to love each other. And can I say this? Can I be bold about this? If we can't love each other because of differing opinions, then the love of Christ is not in us. Or the other alternative is the love of Christ is not authentic, it's not real. Well, we know it's real. That proves that the love of Christ is real. So the challenge is, like Paul is challenging Philemon to love Onesimus, the challenge is that you and I, because of the love of Christ within us, we can love each other. Now, I happen to love Vegemite. I think everybody should eat Vegemite. You may have a different opinion on that one, especially if you're a Canadian and you've eaten Vegemite. People who have never tasted Vegemite reckon it tastes like axle grease. It's very salty. And the worst thing you can do when you get your fresh toast with butter on it is put your Vegemite on like you Canadians put Nutella on. No, it's very strong and salty. Put a thin layer on. Okay, we're going to finish early today so we can go get some toast and Vegemite. You and I think very differently about Vegemite, but we can still love each other. So Paul is saying to Philemon, I'm not ordering you to love Onesimus. I'm asking you because of the love of Christ. And look at this. Here I am, Paul, now an old man. He's not really using his title and authority as one of the great apostle to the Gentiles. He's saying, I'm an old man and I'm in prison. I'm pretty vulnerable right now, says Paul. But I'm doing all of this because of my love for Jesus. And I'm in prison because I love the saints. I'm sharing the gospel with Gentiles, and that's why I'm in prison, says Paul. And I also love you, Philemon. And I pray for you. And by the way, Philemon, don't forget, one of your character quality traits is you love God's holy people. And guess what? Philemon is now one of God's holy people. He was, A few months ago, he was your servant. And he was an indentured slave. He had to work for you for X number of years to pay off the debt. So here's the second point I want to make, and probably this is the take home for me as I prepared this sermon. It might be for you. Here's the first part of the sentence. Love is a decision to be committed to someone. Here's a qualifier. You add this part in. No matter their circumstances. No matter their circumstances. Love is a decision to be committed to someone, no matter their circumstances. You see, if you love someone because you ought to love someone, very difficult to love them in their circumstances. Oh, well, you know, he's a drug addict, so why am I going to love him? But if you love someone because you're motivated by love, you want to love them because of Christ's love in you, it doesn't matter their circumstances. I've told you this before, but I'll repeat this again. Some of you probably haven't heard this story. When Jenny and I got married, two people that both were, we met at an organisation called Jesus People, and it was an organisation that worked for homeless and destitute young people. It wasn't that I was homeless and destitute and Jenny met me on the streets. No, I was working with homeless and destitute young people, and Jenny was working in the administration wing, and we met each other. And two of the leaders from that organisation became very good friends of ours and had a big impact on us. And this one particular guy, who was also coming to the church where I was now coming as a new Christian, and I do believe he knew the Bible off by heart. I travelled across Australia with him once. It takes about 4 days to drive from Perth to Sydney, and we used to do Bible quizzes. I'd get my Bible, and I just flip open and I say, Isaiah 48:13. He quoted. So he's a pretty impressive guy. He became my best man. And the lady that worked at the hostel became Jenny's maid of honor. She wasn't married then, wasn't she? She wasn't married. Maid of honor. Well, after many years, the guy that became my best man was convicted of pedophilia and went to prison. So what did I do? I totally shunned him and never visited him in prison. No, he was still my best man. He was still a good friend of mine. And I loved him. I still love him to this day. He's made some bad choices, but his circumstances didn't determine my love for him. Because I wasn't told to love him. I wanted to love him. Now, before he was convicted and he was high profile and everybody knew him, the guy knew the Bible, everyone would be his friend. Everyone wants to hang around with him. But after he was convicted, nobody wanted to know him. But I did. And if I can say this about one of you, it'd be Ed. Ed is loyal to the nth degree. Fiercely loyal. It doesn't matter what happens, and Ed's proved that in ministry over the years. Not just to me, he's shown that to me, but he's done that over the years. If there's one thing about Ed, you know, he's got a creaky voice because of a virus he had once, and he is fiercely loyal. He loves because he's decided to love. And that's what Paul is trying to say to Philemon. Love is a decision to be committed to somebody. Doesn't matter what they do, I'm going to love you. There's nothing you can do about that. You can hate my guts, you not talk to me, I'm still going to love you. Love is not some gushy feeling. Agape love is not some warm, fuzzy or cold, prickly. Love is a decision to be committed. Imagine if Jesus, on his way to the cross, said, this is too hard. It's going to hurt. Already the lashings, that hurt. I'm not going there. No, he was decided to be committed. If you want a great definition of agape love, the decision to be committed to someone, in spite of your circumstances. Here's a little clue. Don't ask God to help you love someone. That's the wrong prayer. All that does is get you to give the right actions, like help me love Mary, all right, and go buy a bunch of flowers. And no, here's what I would recommend. Ask God to give you the desire to love somebody. Don't ask him to help you love him. It's subtle. Because then what you do is you just do things. You do things that show love. But if you ask God for the desire in your heart, the right motive to love someone, then you can be committed to them, no matter what their circumstances. And I want to say a little aside here. For those of us who maybe are really involved in the digital world, it's really hard to be committed to somebody in love if it's just purely digital. So I'm not saying you can't do it, but it's way more difficult than we might think. I have 300 friends on Facebook. Wow, it has 40,000. Question is, how do you express love? And I want to say to you that true love, agape love, has to work in person. You can do it digitally, I know that, but too many of us have been led to think that our love can be digital. I don't think so, and the world's starting to show that, and I'm not against the technology, don't get me wrong, I love the technology, but in these sorts of things, what you need to do is read Alred of Ravoux on friendship. He wrote a little booklet in 1127, one of my great friends, been dead a long time now. He wrote about spiritual friendship. You have to be in person to do real love. Just imagine if Jesus just sent a text about the crucifixion. I'm just going to do this digitally. There's something about being in person that's unfamiliar for us. So don't ask God to help you. Ask God to get your motive right, to give you the desire. That's way more important. Well, let me sort of come to the third point then. So, Philemon, after all of this that I've been saying to you, what I'm trying to say to you is I'm appealing to you for my own son, Onesimus. Now, your question, a question for you to answer, why does Paul refer to Onesimus as his son? We don't even know if Paul was married. Why does he call Onesimus his son? Ophelia.
He loves him like a son.
He loves him like a son. Yes, it can go further than that. Also, why? A son. Why is Onesimus his son?
Accepted.
Who said that?
Accepted Jesus.
Yeah, yeah. So he's a spiritual son. Dave.
And also, father does he discipline. So father's in a position to discipline him. So he's a spiritual son and he isn't totally disciplined.
Yeah, it's like dad's talking to you. That's another thing in our culture we've got to be really careful of, is this divide between the older generation and the younger generation, and the younger generation who don't think the older generation know anything anymore. That's really dangerous. That happened in Germany. That happens in all totalitarian governments, where the kids rat on the parents because the kids think they're smarter. Well, they are smarter when it comes to coding, writing apps, not smarter in how to live life, to survive in the emotional jungle. So there's this responsibility, like Dave said, of the father to the son. You're my spiritual son. I led you to Christ. You're like a son. So, Philemon, this is how you go about loving Onesimus. This is verses 10 and 11. Onesimus became my son while I was in prison. You've got to wonder what the backstory is there. How did Onesimus meet Paul in prison? And I bet you Onesimus had a guilty conscience. I mean, he'd been serving in a house that had a house church. So you can imagine Onesimus heard the sermons, heard the prayers. He probably heard the gospel. And he ran away and his conscience got to him. I don't know. He met Paul anyway. He got saved. And Paul says, to Philemon, look, he became my son who was in chain while I was in prison. He became a disciple of Jesus. And Paul says, and you read in other places, Paul says that Onesimus became willing to serve at my side. He became a really useful Christian to me. Look at verse 11. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he has become useful both to you and to me. He's become a Christian. He's been converted. Jesus loves him. I love him. And to boot, he's become really useful as a Christian now. Now, I know, writes Paul to Philemon, I know that he was useless to you in the past, but now he's really useful, both you and me. Paul keeps using this word, useful. Guess what the word Onesimus means? Oninomai is the Greek, to be the recipient of help or favour, to be profitable, to be helpful. That's what the word Onesimus means. From the root word onesis, which means to profit. So Paul's playing on this word play, right? This guy whose name is useful has become really useful to me. And you see the depth of that. Philemon's reading into the text now and going, oh my gosh. So this is Paul's motivations. This is his reasoning. Philemon, I don't want to force you to do the right thing. But Onesimus has become a great asset to me. Jesus loves him, and so do I. I love him. And I want you to love him. With the implication we're going to see a bit later on, to take him back and don't punish him. I want you to love him, and the reason I want you to do it is because Jesus loves you. And of course, Jesus loves Onesimus. When you think about that, imagine saying to somebody, you or me, saying, no, I'm not going to love them. I refuse to love them. While you're standing in front of the cross. That's pretty harsh. Here's a symbol of Jesus' love for you, unconditional love for you and me. We're in this together. And yet, you're not willing to do the very thing that he did to you. You're not willing to do it for someone else. You call yourself a Christian. It doesn't work. Maybe you should just say that you're a Christian. Because in means a follower. Christian means a follower of Jesus. You get it? It's pretty harsh. It's subtle, but it's really, really harsh. I want you to love him. I'm not ordering you to love him. I want you to love him because Jesus loves you. And what Paul's actually doing is motivating. He's getting at the root of the motivation for love. Now, not only this, do I want you to love him? But actually, Onesimus has shown some worth. He's been useful in the kingdom. He's now, instead of stealing the china or the silver, he's now useful in the kingdom. He's doing kingdom work. Who knows? He eventually became a bishop, you know, Onesimus, of Syria. So, you know, the possibility of you being a drunk and becoming a bishop is real. Those of you who know my story, that was me. Eventually, you could be useful. Still waiting for that. But the thing is that God has changed Onesimus, and he's got a totally different track record now. Before, he was stealing the cutlery, and now he's really useful to me. So here's the other subtlety I want to add in point three. See here? Responsibility, we're talking about love, but But Paul's pushing it one step further because he's going to, next week, he's going to ask Philemon to take Onesimus back. But to set this up, Paul says here, verse number three in your notes on page 7, responsibility comes with a love for Jesus and a proven track record. You see this? Responsibility comes with a love for Jesus and a proven track record. Philemon, I don't just want you to love Onesimus, but I want you to take him back. I want you to give him responsibility again. But watch this. This is really, really important. If there was a big mistake that the institutional church makes, it loves people and gives them responsibilities without any track record. We're notorious in picking the wrong people for the right jobs. It's classic in the church. Paul is saying, I want you to take him, But I want you to know he's got a track record now. We're not just asking you to love him and give him responsibility willy-nilly. We're asking you, I'm asking you, says Paul to Philemon, take him back because he's got a track record. Because Philemon could just say, well, I love you and forgive you, God bless you, have a nice day. No, no, I love you, I forgive you, and now I'm going to give you responsibility. And we know that that happened because the letter exists, and Philemon became, and Onesimus became a great bishop. Please note, love for Jesus does not guarantee responsibility. And I'll say this to you, and I've said this over the years of leadership, frankly, even if you love Jesus, you may not get the job of being a lay administrator, worship leader, a deacon in the church until you've got a track record. That's why one of the policies of this community is you come, you join the community. We don't have membership. You can get your name on the contact list so we can contact each other, but we don't have a membership. But you come as a new person, you don't get to do any major jobs for at least a year. I mean, you can help sweep the floor and move chairs, but in terms of ministry responsibility, for at least a year. One, because you need to get to know us, you need to get to know me. You might discover after a year I'm a real fruitcake and you don't want to really be here. But we also get to know you. We had, several years ago now, we had a young man came to the church. He was a guitarist. First Sunday, because we were looking for a music director, like we are at the moment, and he came and he said, first Sunday, well, I'll be your music director. I love you dearly as a brother, but responsibility has to come with a track record. And you show me your CV, your resume, well, it's not going to have all the bad stuff in there. It's going to have all the good stuff. The only way we're going to do this is you get to know me and I get to know you and we work out how that works. So you need a proven track record. And Onesimus had the track record, even though he was loved. And we have to be really, really careful in the church. Like I said before, you harness strengths, you nullify weaknesses, and you let people... Look, I'll give you a classic example, and I've said this to you many times. In the 40 years, over 40 years of ministry that Jenny and I have done, no one has ever once, ever asked me to sing publicly. Never once. And you know why? I have a track record. When I sing publicly, people call 911. Someone screaming in agony in the building next door. Quick, get the ambulance. No, never once. But let me tell you this. Guess how many times I've been asked, and I've never promoted myself, I've been asked to preach all over the world. Many, many times. Because a track record, right? People recognize your gifts. So when people come to you and say to you, in leadership, would you like to help with this job? That's because they recognize the gifts in you. In dysfunctional churches that don't understand this principle, they just say, we need someone to help. Anybody put their hand up, get a volunteer. That's the worst way to get someone in a ministry job. Because if you're not self-aware, you might be a guy like me and say, yeah, I'd like to lead the music. And everybody thinks you've got a terrible voice, and the only person who doesn't know you've got a terrible voice is you. You know what I'm getting at? This responsibility and love, Paul has got this worked out. And we need to get that worked out. I love you, that's great. But I'm not going to give you responsibility. I'm not going to take you back, Onesimus, without a track record. And I love it. You can write this down, Proverbs 18:6. This is in the NASB. But this is a great principle of life. A person's gift makes room for him and leads him before important people. See, if you have a gift, the people will recognize it and the doors will open for you. You don't have to push doors. You don't have to... People will recognize the gift in you. So that's my point number three. Responsibility comes with a love for Jesus and a proven track record. So let me conclude. Paul is talking to Philemon about Onesimus, but what you and I are learning is all about the motivation for love. How do you love somebody? Especially someone who's wronged you. Well, I could stand up here and sprout out orders. You better go love them. And that's going to be about as helpful as swimming in quicksand. You can't force people to love people, especially godly love. Paul has identified that actually love is a decision that we make, you and I make, individually to be committed to someone. And you can meditate a little bit about what it means to be committed to somebody. Well, I write them a Christmas card once a year. That's not real love. Here's the truth. Unlike the digital world, human beings can only love so many people. You can only live in community with so many people. The monastics taught us that. And thirdly, Paul, by extension, is teaching us that when you love people, you don't just open the door to them and give them all sorts of responsibilities just because you love them. They've got to have a track record. Doesn't mean you don't love them, but you be careful about giving them responsibilities. Just because you love them, you don't give them the responsibilities. They've got to prove that. So I've got three questions for you. This is your homework for this week. This is your homework. Here's the first question. Think about it for this coming week. Who is a person that you should love this week? Not because you have to, but because you want to. Think of a person. Is there somebody? It might not be, but is there somebody this week that you should be loving? Not because you ought to. Not because you find it, I should. No, because you want to. Is there a person this week? And I don't mean digital. Don't send them a text, I love you. No. Is there a person you can see in person, even if you do it socially distanced, wear masks, whatever, do it on the other side of a glass, whatever, however you feel, comfortable or not, whatever. But is there a person somewhere that you could love this week because you want to? And here's a question I want you to ask yourself about another person. Is there a person in your life who has proven themselves in their actions to you? Is there a person in your life who has a track record, who's proven in their actions their love for you. Or just even just proven themselves. I can trust that person. They're good on their word. And then think of the other side. Is there a person in your life who has not proven themselves in their track record, even though they love you? Maybe a Christian person. Because words are cheap. It's easy, yeah, I love you. So, three people to think about. Somebody that you should go and love this week, not because you ought to, but because you want to. Somebody that's proven themselves to you because of their actions, and somebody who's not proven themselves to you because of their actions. Janice?
I'm just thinking about this. Do you think this person knew what the contents of the letter?
Yeah. Yeah, I think he did, because if Onesimus went back to Philemon as a Christian, he would be getting it right. You know, the AA do that. Ed keeps reminding us of that. You know, getting all the things, the inventory. He was going to eventually go back to Philemon and say, I'm sorry. Here's the silverware.
Okay, so I'm just wondering if the letter was more for Onesimus than it was for, I mean, loving people seem to come naturally for Philemon.
Yeah, but probably in this situation,
yeah.
Taking back a slave who's stolen the jewelry, pretty tough. And in fact, there is a thinking that if Paul didn't actually write the letter to Philemon, Onesimus may never have been taken back. So Onesimus knew that Paul was writing. Whether he knew the exact contents of the letter, probably. But the letter, because Paul would have discussed it with him, but Paul addressed it and would have been sealed, and it was sent via Tychicus to Philemon. Onesimus knew what was at least in the motive of the letter. And the thinking is that Paul probably needed to write this letter. If he didn't, the possibility is that Onesimus may not have been taken back. Just goes to prove that Philemon wasn't perfect either, even though he loved the saints. It's much easier to love all the saints who are really nice to you. But what about the saints who have sinned you, against you, stabbed you in the back? How do you love them? So, three people to think about this week on these principles. Can't be ordered to love someone. You've got to be decided to be committed. And responsibility comes with a track record. So you're going to look for someone that you should be loving or that you think you need to love this week just because you really want to. Think about someone who's got a track record that's proven themselves to you. Think about someone who hasn't proven themselves to you because of their track record. Let me pray. Father God, thank you for this letter of Paul to Philemon and the amazing things that we can learn and apply in our own lives because of this letter and your words of scripture. Burn them into our souls, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Before we finish with communion, we get the opportunity to share the peace together. Oh, and today we've also got a special commissioning service as well. But before we do that, we're going to share the peace. Could I ask you to please stand? And, well, you've been doing this for weeks now. Be sensitive to each other, those who need to be distanced, maybe shake hands with some, bump fists, high five, whatever. Just be sensitive to each other. We all know where we're at, but we're going to share the peace either way because it's a great privilege. So I say to you, brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Great. You go share that peace, make our visitors welcome. I only have one announcement for this week, and that is that we started our Thursday support group last Thursday, 6 o'clock. Come have dinner together, fellowship for an hour, and prayer and Bible study for about an hour. And that seemed to work really well. And if you've noticed, we've now got plastic film on all the windows to stop the cold draft, so that the building is actually getting warmer now than it used to be. So Thursday night, you're all welcome and you can bring friends. And the whole purpose of the Thursday support group is a way to support each other. Find ways. Somebody needs a job, like at the moment Shelley's looking for work, we're going to try and find her a job. Somebody needs help with this, he needs some money here, some vegetables here, whatever. It's sort of like an alternative community, the one that the government has offered us at the moment, which is stay locked inside and don't talk to anybody. You can be safe distanced or whatever, but we are going to care for each other. So that's Thursday. Everyone is welcome. And those of you who came last Thursday have said to me that you thought it was worthwhile and useful, and we're going to keep doing it. And we'll incorporate prayer and Bible study in that as well. Open to anybody, as long as you feel comfortable being, you know, together in a space, and we're going to eat together as well. You're more than welcome to join us.
Explain about the food.
Food, just bring your own, or what some of us have done is go across the road, order the food, pick it up for 6 o'clock, and then we eat together. So you bring your own, buy some food once a week, get a hamburger across the road, fish and chips, whatever. But the idea is that we eat together in community. Eventually, when the building's set up and got the kitchen set, well, we can have a potluck together and stuff, and we'll be doing that as well. But for now, we eat together, get your own, bring it, and fellowship. Today is the first Sunday in February. Can you believe it? I'm already preparing my sermons for Advent. But first Sunday of the month, we celebrate, and Elaine told me that Niall's birthday, they're not coming because that family is being isolated and they're just really careful. So, but we still keep in touch with them and celebrate. So Niall's got a birthday this month.
Actually, they've got people pray for them because they have COVID right now.
Oh.
Just getting over it. Of course, the parents got it worse.
Right.
What
an irony, and all the protection that they've done, and they got COVID anyway. Well, listen, why don't we do that right now? Would someone pray for anybody who might know the Irwin family? Just pray out loud for the Irwin family. Would one of you do that right now? Amen. Amen. Thank you, Janice. So, if you have a birthday in February, I want you to come forward, please, so we can pray with you and bless you. Birthdays in February. 42.
32.
Plus 20.
Come on.
Anniversary.
And anniversaries. Beg your pardon. Sorry. Did I just say birthdays, right? Are you having a birthday or an anniversary? Come on. You guys have a birthday or anniversary? I'm just thinking, you're not too shy to come forward, are you? Okay, that's good. Okay, birthday or anniversary?
Birthday.
Birthday?
Birthday.
Anniversary. Anniversary. How many, Carolyn?
60.
60.
Wow.
Wow. And you know, the way I calculate that, that's actually 120 years. Because it's 60 each. They've both been working on it. So that makes 120. So that is fantastic. Congratulations. And birthday. Great. Well, normally we would hold hands, but I'm just going to pray for you right now. And while I pray for them and bless them, would you pray and bless for them? Bless them as well? Let's do that. So, Father God, thank you for birthdays and anniversaries. Thank you that because of birthdays, these people are here. And because of anniversaries, we celebrate life with our spouses. And so, Father God, I ask your blessing on these people. Give them many more years of health and wisdom as they navigate the spiritual world. Give them many more years of rhythm and life that you've given them so far. And we ask your blessing on them in the years to come and on the day of their celebration. We thank you for them. We ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
It's Anne King's birthday today, too.
Sorry?
It's Anne King's birthday.
Anne King's birthday today as well. Thank you. Great. Just before we do the offering, I thought I'd share this with you. Does anybody want to see what this picture is?
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Anybody?
Yeah.
Yes.
Good. Good. I thought you would. So I'll set this up. I meet every month or two. In fact, it's Todd and Rita's daughter-in-law, Chelsea, who's a therapist, and she works with a young man who's autistic. And she's been working with him for about 13 years now, right? Long time, since he was young. He's now 25, and he's learned to speak again, and he's come a long, long way. And so they come to the church because he wanted to meet an Anglican priest. He just wanted to meet an Anglican. And so we set up a little table at the back and we have a visit for a couple of hours. And we've been meeting together and he's been asking questions. And he is amazingly intelligent. Like, he knows stuff that many people have never heard of. He quoted to a card, Alred of Revaux. Most Christians have never even heard of him. He's one of my best friends. And so Jake wanted to draw a picture of me that was a symbolism of the spirituality that I represented to him. Because we become friends, thanks to Chelsea. So he did this picture of me, a symbolic picture of me, of the spirituality of me. Is there anybody who would like to see it?
Yes.
So I'm going to leave it at the back table. Right? So just a couple of things.
Show the people that are watching too.
Oh, yeah. Here, people. Have a look at that. So, a couple of things that just to highlight. He's got, because I don't belong to the Church of Canada anymore. Oh, sorry, Todd, I'll just stand here. Thank you. Because I don't belong to the Church of Canada anymore, he made a little Aussie Anglican symbol, and he's got what's called an out mitre. A mitre is what a bishop wears, but this is for the outback. And so this is an outback mitre, which is like an Aussie hat, right? And he's drawn that. And the Holy Bible and the Book of Common Prayer. He's not an Anglican, but he knows all of this stuff. And then the lappets, what the traditional Anglican church would wear, these things from their mitre, the two little lappets called, that hang back from the... from the mitre, which is the pointy cap that the bishops wear, right? And he did that as symbolism of this, the two lappets. So it's really amazing picture for an autistic guy who's come a long way, and he writes amazingly well and draws. So I'm going to leave this at the back of the church. You can have a look at it. It was a real blessing and very, very precious. We're going to commission somebody because they have a track record. And we've asked Janice to pray about it, and we've worked it out, and we've set up a job description for her and all that. And Janice today is going to become our prayer coordinator, and she's taking over from Jenny. And Janice and Mike have been faithful prayer warriors for many, many years. Talk about a track record in prayer. And it's great because it involves other people in ministry, and it releases Jenny to do some other ministry as well. And we're going to commission Janice today. So Janice, would you please come forward? And I'm going to ask those of you who are the elders who are here today, please come forward as well. And I think Nick Tony is the only other elder who's not here. So if you stand there, face me. And we're going to ask her a question, and then we're going to pray for her. And I'm going to ask one of the elders, I'm going to ask maybe Bruce today, if you would also do a prayer for her at the end, if that's okay. So, you'll see this on page 12, so you can follow through with us. It is the duty of the prayer coordinator to cooperate with the pastor to carry out the responsibilities which you have undertaken to perform. The prayer team coordinator will perform her duties according to the Word of God, the leading of the Holy Spirit, and the support of the leadership team, the elders. Janice, will you conscientiously render your gift of prayer leadership and support to the Lord, Pastor, and leaders in the work and the witness of the Church of Jesus Christ here in this parish of All Saints Community Church?
I will, the Lord being my helper.
Well then, in the presence of this congregation, I install you as the prayer team coordinator in this parish of All Saints Community Church in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And everyone said?
Amen.
Let us pray. Before I say this prayer, Bruce, wonder if, and I'll get you to turn around so we can hear you, and you pray for her as well. Let's pray. And can we lay hands on Janice?
Father, I just thank you for Janice, and Lord, thank you for the heart you have given her to be a prayer warrior, and the compassion that you have given her, Lord, for the people of your congregation here, Lord. And we just ask that you just continue to pour out your gifting on her, Lord, so that she may represent you to us, and that she may pray for the needs of our congregation. We pray for this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. So let us pray together, church. Lord, we pray you keep your household, the church, in continual godliness, that through prayer and worship we are devoutly given to serve you to the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord. And everyone said,
Amen. Amen.
Can we welcome Janice?
So that also means if people have prayer requests, they can send them to Janice and she will send them out to them.
That's what I was just going to say.
Sorry.
So just if you didn't hear that, Janice is taking over three areas of responsibility. She's coordinating the prayer chain. We have about 10 people, is it, on a prayer chain who will pray at any time. If you send us a request, we'll send it out to the prayer chain. You've been, in the past, you've been sending prayer requests to me or to Jenny. If you send them to me, I just pass them on to Jenny. Now you can send them directly to Janice, and she'll send them out to the prayer team. You know who's on the prayer team, and they are people who are committed to praying. Janice and Mike will also be available to pray, and when we finally get the building done, to have prayer teams for prayer during communion. Like today, after communion, if you would like prayer, or during communion, there'll be Janice and Mike will be at the back praying. Special Sundays when we have like healing prayer Sundays, like the last Sunday of the year when Ed comes and preaches, we'll have prayer teams. Janice will coordinate the prayer team. So the prayer chain, the prayer teams, and then as we get back to eventually having some form of push prayer, which is pray until something happens, push prayer, which is our weekly prayer meetings, we're not doing them just yet because we're still trying to work out the routine of the church. Janice will be helping with those as well, coordinating that. So lots of prayer in the church. And we thank Janice for her Janice and Mike, what a team. So God bless you and thank you and congratulations. Thank you for serving. Awesome. Let's get back to communion.
Many people wonder where is God when I need him. During the Jesus movement, a Roman Catholic teenager, she wanted to receive Jesus, but she thought she could only receive him in a church building. So we took over a church building and she accepted Jesus. So where is God? He's here, he's with us, wherever. Isn't that amazing good news? The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
That's even better news, isn't it?
Yes.
So lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you with saints and angels praising you and singing.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took a cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you this bread of life and the cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes again. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And now we pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from
evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power,
for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Well, church, I think we've done church. I think God's been pleased with what we've done. You've been touched. I've been encouraged. Holy Spirit has manifested his presence here today. Thank you, Jesus, an answer to prayer. Can we say this prayer after communion on page 19? Let's pray this together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom we offer our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. And for the blessing, are there any kids who want to help me with the blessing today? Come on. Come on, kids. Let's go. Here we go. Come on the back here. Come on, kids. Ready? We're going to stand up behind the altar here. Ready? Congregation, can you please stand? Ready, we're going to point to the cross. Here we go. All our problems. All our difficulties. What are you going to do about the devil's works? And all our hopes. Thank you, kids. Good job. Well, listen, just before you go, can I remind you of Paul's challenge to you and to me? You love because you want to, not because you have to. And remember that it's a decision that you make, and people have to earn the responsibility. You can love them, but they still earn the responsibility. So this week you're going to go look for some people that you can love and remember who have really touched you. So go forth into the world in peace. Come on, Oceana, come up here. Go forth into the world in peace and be of good courage and fight the good fight of faith so that you may finish your course with joy. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest on you and those you love, now and forever. Amen.
Bye. go in peace, to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.